Good morning. Good morning. Glad to hear about everybody out with us today. We've got a good crowd here today. First Sunday in October. I wonder what happened to the other 9 months of the year. Glad to have you if you're visiting with us. Glad to have you if you're a regular member. I'd like to ask everybody to take an attendance card from the back of the pew in front of you and fill it out, drop it in the collection basket up either up here or as you go out the door, so we'd have a record of your attendance. Also, there's a printed announcement sheet in the foyer if you'd like to have one of those. Our sick list today, Linda Robertson is listed at home recovering surgery, but I saw her here today, so glad to have her feeling well enough to be back with us. Don Rector is at home from the hospital. I think he has some further tests scheduled later on this week. Hunter Heatherly, the newborn son of Chesley and Mary Heatherly, is in the hospital in Tupelo. Pat Stevens is home recovering from hip surgery. Joel Gunnell is Kim Robertson's father, is receiving rehab at DiversiCare in Winfield. As always, remember our shut-ins in your prayers. Robbie Collins, Patricia Cunningham, Lola Mae Edwards, J.C. Hutchinson, Alton Rector, Martha Rye, Josie, Norma Stanford, and Mary Thomas. On our upcoming activities, Bible Bowl practice is today at 4 o'clock. The Bible Bowl is tonight at Mount Olive. There's a bridal shower for Logan Thomas in the fellowship room from 2 to 3 today. October the 2nd through the 5th, there's a gospel meeting at the Fayette Church of Christ. There are more details on the bulletin board out front. And October the 16th, the area-wide youth series will be here at Vernon. Our services today will be led in singing by Brother Glenn Barden, be led in prayer at the proper time by Brother Robert McNeese. The Lord's Supper will be presided over by Brother Lynn Pennington, and then our sermon will be delivered by our regular minister, Brother Eddie Finch. Remember, our service is here this afternoon at 5 o'clock and Wednesday at 7 o'clock. Be back with us whenever you have the opportunity. Bow with me, we'll pray. Thank you, Lord, for this day and all the blessings that you continually bestow upon us. Thank you now for this opportunity that we have to enter into this worship service. Please be with us in all that is said and done, that your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. We pray today especially for those of our number that are sick and shut in. Please be with them, be with those ministering to them, that they may be returned to their places in life. Continue now with us through this day. Forgive us for our sins as we repent and turn from them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The reading for the contribution this morning will be Proverbs 11 and 20, verse 25. The generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will also be watered himself. Let us give thanks. Our Heavenly Father, we're so thankful to you this morning for this beautiful Lord's Day and for the good health that allows us to come together and offer you our worship. Father, we pray that the things that we say and do today will be well-pleasing in your sight. Father, at this time, we'd truly like to thank you for all the many wonderful blessings that you have provided for each one of us. We've realized, Father, that all these good gifts come from you. At this time, Lord, we'd like to return a portion of these good gifts back to you so that the work of your church may continue. Help each one of us to do so with a free-hearted and giving spirit. This we pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Reading for the Lord's Supper this morning will be Mark 14, verses 55 through 65. Now the chief priest and all the council sought testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but found none. For many bore false witness against him, but their testimonies did not agree. Then some rose up and bore false witness against him, saying, "We heard him say, 'I will destroy the temple made with hands, and within 3 days I will build another made without hands.' But not even then did their testimony agree. And the high priest stood up in the midst and asked Jesus, saying, 'Do you answer nothing? What is it these men testify against you?' But he kept silent and answered nothing. Again the high priest asked him, saying to him, 'Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed?' Jesus said, 'I am, and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven.' Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, 'What further need do we have of witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?' And they all condemned him to be deserving of death. Then some began to spit on him and to blindfold him and to beat him and to say to him, 'Prophesy.' And the officers struck him with the palms of their hands." Let us give thanks for the bread. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this bread that represents your Son's blessed body that was freely sacrificed on the cross for our sins. Help each one of us to partake of it, Lord, in a well-pleasing manner. This we pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Father, in like manner, we thank you for this fruit of the vine that represents your Son's precious blood that was freely given on the cross for our sins. Again, Father, help each one of us to reflect back on that great sacrifice that he made for us. This is our prayer in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Thank you. Bow with me, please. Most Holy Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for this opportunity to meet out, to study a portion of thy word, and to sing these hymns, to worship you. Pray, Heavenly Father, that all that we do here and the world over, we would do those things which are acceptable unto thee, those things which you would have us to do, that we would ever look to pleasing thee, that we might bring joy to your heart. Pray, Heavenly Father, that thou would forgive us of our sins and shortcomings, for we know that we do often fail thee. Pray that thou would help us to study thy word, to rightly divide it, and to constantly grow in being able to correctly discern it. Heavenly Father, we thank thee for those the world over who are laboring in hard and difficult places to spread the borders of thy kingdom. Especially pray for the Landises as they struggle in the Philippines. Pray that thou would continue to bless their work, that thy children might grow there, both in spirit and in number. Pray, Heavenly Father, that thou would be with the leaders of this congregation. Pray that the elders would make those decisions which would keep us close to thy word. Pray that we would always be looking to thy word as our guide, that we would get all of our direction from it. Pray, thank thee, Heavenly Father, that thou hast provided thy spirit to help us as we struggle upon this earth. Pray that thou would help us to always be thankful for whatever comes our way, that we might be molded and prepared, that someday we could be in a condition that would be acceptable unto thee, that we might have eternal life. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. those temptations will allow to Christians will be disappointed. Quit being a Christian, get along the Lord,
forsake the assembly of ourselves together. That's going to be the greatest temptation, I believe, that every Christian will have in their life, will simply be to quit. Jesus always encouraged his disciples to not only begin the Christian life, but he encouraged them to hang in there and finish the Christian life. That's his encouragement to them. He wanted them to start, and he wanted them to complete what they had started. Employers, they have things they look at whenever they see employees beginning to show signs of quitting. And they can look at these things and say, okay, he or she's not going to be around very much longer because look at what he or she's doing or saying. And one thing they say, or a couple things they give as signs of this, would be they don't have the team spirit. They're always out here isolated to themselves, not really functioning with the other employees. They're out there by themselves. A second thing they say, their work begins to slack off. They're not as productive as they once were, and that's very noticeable. And the third thing they begin to notice is they come in late more often, and they want more time off more often. Coming in late, need more time off. And they say when you begin to see those three things happening, you know that employee will not be around much longer. Very seldom do they say that you have an individual that just comes in one day and says, I quit. That doesn't happen that often, but it does happen. A good example of this would be back in 2018, an NFL player by the name of Vontae Davis. He played 10 years with the Indianapolis Colts. Well, he's a defensive back, and as they were playing against the LA Chargers in 2018, during halftime, he just quit. He didn't come back out on the field. And when he was asked, why did you do that? He said it just didn't feel right anymore. So after a 10-year season, one game during the halftime, he quit. Quit on the team. Well, if it can happen within employment, it can also happen when it comes to the church as well. There are signs as well, and they're very similar to what you would see in a state of employment. Individuals begin to give these signs. Isolation from the church. They don't have anything to really do with the church anymore. They sort of be out there on their own. Are they not as involved as they once were in activities? They're beginning to, again, separate themselves from individuals from the church. And they're finding more and more excuses to quit or miss church services. More and more excuses. Anything will do. Anything will come up. Whatever it may be, and they're gone, and they're out. Again, very few ever just say one day, one Sunday, well, I quit. Well, I have known very few to do that, but again, there again, most of the time there's signs of individuals or Christians about to give up on the Lord. Well, we can't do that. And the reason we can't do that, our soul is too important. And we begin to focus on things that maybe the devil wants us to focus on, and we forget about finishing the race, finishing our life faithful. In Hebrews chapter 12, first Matthew 10:22, but he who endures to the end will be saved. In Revelation 2 and verse 10, be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. Two of many verses where the Lord is encouraging us to hang in there. And don't quit, and don't give up. And we have many individuals in the Bible who were, I guess you might say, tempted to quit, just like we have been or are right now. Many individuals, but they didn't quit. For example, in Hebrews 12, verse 1, the writer says, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, who are these witnesses? You have to go to chapter 11, back up to chapter 11. And there you find individual after individual of these great individuals who were faithful to the Lord, but yet they had their temptations at times just to quit. It was there before them. So when we get this feeling that, well, I think I'll quit, that nobody else has ever had this problem before. All we got to do is go to Hebrews 12:1, and there he says, these witnesses who have been in the same shoes that we've been in, and probably even worse, what they went through than for us. And he says there, continues, let us lay aside every weight and sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. It can happen. We can become weary. We can become discouraged just because of life, or maybe some things that even happen while we're involved at church. These things can happen to us. But yet he's telling us here, look at those who made it, the great cloud of witnesses. They finished the race. They finished the race, and he wants us to do the same. Some of those witnesses would be Moses. In Numbers 11, verse 15, Moses asked God to take his life. He was tired of it, tired of what he was having to go through. He got discouraged. He was ready to quit. In the book of Job, in Job, the third chapter, Job cursed the day he was born. And he says, if that weren't enough, why couldn't I just have died the day that I was born? He didn't want to go on anymore. Again, being discouraged by this. Abraham, in Genesis chapter 16, he gave up on, about to give up on God's promise of ever having a son. But God came through and they had Isaac. Elijah, in 1 Kings chapter 19, two times he asked God to take his life. He was discouraged. He was ready to quit. And Paul, in 2 Corinthians 1 and verse 8, he talks about having the despair even of life. It seems there that Paul, what he was going through, he was about ready to say, enough's enough. He was despaired with life and ready to lay it aside, but yet he didn't. And if we've ever thought about quitting, as we can see here, we're in good company. Because these and so many more thought about it, but they didn't do it. They completed, they finished the race. And if we ever have that thought, and we probably have, we need to think about some things. Think about, why do I want to quit? Why would I want to do this? Paul is warning the Galatians. They're thinking about quitting Christianity and going back to their old ways. Old ways under the law, or just whatever they want to do. And he says, oh, foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you that you should not obey the truth? Before your eyes, Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed among you as crucified. He says, who has bewitched you? Who has tricked you into thinking that it's okay to go back? And so many times when we are tempted with this acquitting, somebody has put a little bug in our ear somewhere that it's not worth it. It's more fun elsewhere. You could do something even more that you want to do. There's no limits to what you can do. And on it goes, and finally it begins to build up in us maybe. And it may be that somebody has done this to us, convinced us of such. Paul says, foolish Galatians. We don't want to be foolish. That's foolish to think that way. To think that there's a better way than the way of Christ, and to give up. Demas, somebody convinced him, tricked him. 2 Timothy 4:10. For Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world. Somebody convinced him to go back into his old ways. He probably regrets it now if he didn't come back to the Lord. So therefore, we need to ask why. And it may be that we're being encouraged by, you know, the devil or who knows who's out there, encouraging us to just quit. Don't let that happen. Sometimes when it comes to quitting, People feel that Christianity isn't filling their needs. They may say, well, I became a Christian, but I still suffer. I became a Christian, I still have anxiety. I still get depressed. I still have my marital problems. I still have my financial problems. I still have my addictions. I still am self-centered. I have no confidence. I don't see where it's helped me any. And some may ask that question. Well, sometimes people may become Christians with the wrong expectations. Because life does get better in many ways, but sometimes these problems may still abound. Especially if we don't seek after the Lord and follow after his ways. Matthew 7, 13 and 14. Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way which leads to destruction, and there are many who go in by it. Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it. The narrow way will be a difficult way. Not could be a possibility. It's going to be a difficult way. Narrow. But it's the only way if we want to go and be with God for all eternity. Peter backs it up, 1 Peter 4:16. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed. Let him glorify God in this matter. It's going to happen. I only hope one day that these problems of life that we have, they'll be taken care of, no more put behind us, because none of that stuff that gives us the problems today will be around in heaven. I want to be faithful to that day. Another thing to consider, and that is, before quitting, that would be the consequences. There will be consequences, and not just necessarily on me, the individual, but those around me. 2 Peter 2:20 through 22. For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and they are again entangled in them and overcome, the latter end is worse for them than the beginning. For it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness, than having known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered to them. But it has happened to them according to the true proverb, a dog returns to his own vomit, and a sow having washed to her wallowing in the mire. That's going to happen. If a person becomes a Christian and they go back into the world, leave the Lord, leave his church, he says here it's going to be worse for that individual in judgment than it would have been if they had never become a Christian. Don't go back on the Lord. It's worse. How it can be worse, we talked about different degrees of punishment when it comes to hell. Nobody wants to be there on any degree. But apparently for the person who leaves the Lord, that punishment couldn't be any worse. It's going to be the ultimate punishment. And that's not good. But there are going to be consequences for this to happen. He talks here a little bit about the dog eating the vomit and the sow going back to the mire. I've been around pigs most all my life, and I can understand why a pig gets in the mud hole. Man, it's cool. It's refreshing. Just wallow all in it. Don't have a care in the sun. But, you know, nothing better than a pig in the sunshine, you know. But the other one, the dog, I don't get that while the dog does it. I don't see how a dog can eat his vomit. But there are those who've done studies on this thing, and they say that the dog doesn't really see the vomit. What the dog sees is what he just ate. That's what he's thinking about. So when he does what he does here, he's thinking about how good it was, you know, when I first ate. Sometimes Christians will do that. They'll begin thinking, well, I was having so much more fun before I became a Christian. I wasn't confined to, you know, going to church every Sunday. I could go here and I could go there. And I wasn't confined to, I wanted to do what I want to do. And they begin thinking the way it was beforehand. And they don't see the sinful life as vomit. They don't see that. But the devil has a way of blinding them. Again, think about the consequences. Eternity. And loss throughout all eternity. That'd be a terrible thing to go through. Another thing, your name is going to be removed from the book of life. Remember that? Revelation 3:5. He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. If you're faithful, he's not going to blot your name out. The opposite would be, if you're unfaithful, he will. And then Revelation 20:15, and anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Your name's not there. Either has never been there, or once it was once there and taken out. Either way, the lake of fire is going to be one's eternal home. We don't want that. Christ said this to his disciples. They were all excited about doing miraculous works when they went out on their what is called the limited commission. Look what he tells in Luke 10:20. Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, but that the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Boy, what a great reason to rejoice. And we should be thankful every day. And in our prayers, we should be thanking God that you put my name there. And what a blessing. Unless our name's there, heaven's not going to be our home. How terrible it will be to go through all eternity knowing, going through eternity lost in a devil's hell, knowing it once was there. I had it. I just didn't finish it. That would be a terrible thing to go through for all eternity. It will never end. Who's this going to affect if I do quit? Again, 1 Peter 2:21. It's going to affect me, but it's going to affect others as well. You can't just quit and it not have an effect on someone else. Maybe your spouse. Maybe your spouse was that close to doing what was right, and then you started playing with this thing, and now he sees it's not important, or she does, or it may be a child or children. It's going to affect them, no doubt. It may be a friend that you've been talking to, but now they see that you quit, then why do anything? Too often, quitters, they only focus on themselves and not on those around them that are lost. Think about them. James talks about that, James 5:19-20. Brethren, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone turns him back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save a soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. Only the faithful have a concern for the lost. The unfaithful are not going to talk to them because it'd be like a hypocrite thing they would do. Let me tell you, you need to come back, you need to go to church. And he'd turn around and say, well, don't you go. You need to come back. You quit. Well, you quit as well. It's not going to work. The faithful, you go to those who have wandered from the truth. Quit thinking about ourselves and think about those who are lost. We've got to finish the race and get the crown. Revelation 2:10, be faithful in the death. I will give you a crown of life, or the crown of life. And then James 1:12, blesses the man who endures temptation. For when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love him. 1 Peter 5:4. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. That's what we want. And it's only going to be for the faithful. Not the unfaithful. Not those who quit. Not those who've gotten so close to that finish line. It's not a matter, I've done this much. I'm 90% there. But no, it's got to be 100%. We're to be faithful to the Lord all our life. Not just a percentage, but all our life. And when we get to thinking about quitting, as Hebrews 12:2 says, looking unto Jesus, he didn't quit. If he had, there'd be no need for us to be here. But the joy that was set before him, not the joy of the suffering that he was going through, but the joy of knowing I am doing this so others can be saved and be with me one day there in heaven. That's the joy he looked forward to, being with us one day there in heaven. I hope you're looking forward to that joy. And this, whenever the temptation happens, look unto Christ. He didn't quit. I'm not going to quit. I'm going to make it through. I'm going to finish the race. What I'll do, complete the course. If you're not a Christian, you need to start. You need to start today by being baptized into Christ and begin your walk with our Lord today and finish it. And finish to the end, faithful to the end. And you know that heaven will be your home, living a faithful life. Or as a Christian who has laid it aside, unfaithful, you need to get back on track. We never know when the end of the course is going to come about. It may be sooner than we think. But we need to be prepared for that time to make sure we're right with our Lord, finish the race. As Christians, may we go to God's word and learn of this and encourage us and look at these examples to never quit. And when that temptation comes, whenever that happens, a little buzz in our ear begins to happen, a little voice maybe, remember, I'm going to be faithful. I'm not quitting this. It's too important. If that need is there this morning to become a Christian or come home, do so while we stand and sing our invitation.